We are here for the 12th talk in the series Wisdom for Living. This series has been conceptualized by our international president, Mr. Tim Boyd, who strongly believes that spirituality is not something rarefied or even that can be compartmentalized, but needs to be interwoven and integrated into our daily lives. Hence, these lectures feature speakers spanning the entire spectrum of human activity, from business, the arts, fitness, ecology, science, spirituality, etc. That is to say, talks by people who have found ways to apply spiritual principles to their work and living. For those who are new to TS here, Theosophical Society, here's a brief introduction to TS and Theosophy. Theosophical Society was founded in New York in 1875, and the principal founders were Henry Steele Olcott, a retired colonel in the American Army, and Madame Helena Petrovna Blavatsky, a Russian noblewoman with extraordinary occult powers. The founders came to Madras in 1882, and while they were here, they were taken to see a property at Adyar. At that time, it was called Huddleston Gardens, and that place is this one. Today, it's called the Theosophical Society. This became, and still is, the international headquarters of the Theosophical Society worldwide. Theosophy. Theosophy believes in unity of all life. As the mystic poet Rumi has put it, consciousness is sleeping in the mineral, dreaming in the plant, awake in the animal, and attains self-realization in man. When we realize this at the deepest level, universal brotherhood, an object of the TS, becomes a living force in our daily lives. The mission statement of the TS has been approved and can be stated as I quote, to serve humanity by cultivating an ever-deepening understanding and realization of the ageless wisdom spiritual self-realization and unity of all life, unquote. Thus, by living our lives at the deepest level, we may attempt to rise above all our petty selves and dedicate our lives to serving those in need. In this session, we have an eminent speaker amongst us, Dr. Kousalya Nathan. Please welcome. Yeah. Here's a brief, I want to have the floor to Dr. Kousalya Nathan. Her biodata is very long. I mean, she needs no introduction actually to people who watch TV and other things. She's a very, very eminent person. But nevertheless, for the occasion, I have to give an introduction. Dr. Kousalya Nathan has over 25 years of clinical practice and research experience in the field of lifestyle medicine, anti-aging, and regenerative medicine. After a basic medical qualification in the field of naturopathy and yogic sciences, she did her international certification as an American board certified physician and diplomat in the field of anti-aging and regenerative medicine, USA. Her doctorate was on biochemical and behavioral aspects of obesity and its methodology of reversal through the gradual calorie restrictions. From this doctorate was obtained from the Faculty of Medicine, Chettinad Academy of Research and Education, Chettinad University. She's a very well-known keynote speaker in various nutrigenomics and anti-aging conference globally. Her impressive success rate with complex lifestyle disease management, as well as facilitating health goals through precision nutrition and effective lifestyle intervention, has distinguished her as one of the foremost sought after lifestyle and wellness consultants in India. Her clients include personalities from every walk in life, from high-profile bureaucrats, film actresses, film stars, celebrities, senior police officials, IAS officials, chairmen, multinational companies, etc. A popular face in both electronic and social media, Dr. Kousalya Nathan has become a household name renowned for her sustainable and effective solutions to common lifestyle disorders. She has to her credit several articles in national and international publications of repute. She has been interviewed in several print media, including The Hindu, Times of India, Anand Vigadan, Kumudam, Mangayar Malar, to quote a few. And she has also been a popular guest in Jaya TV, Vijay TV, Sun Music, Kalinger TV, Sun News, Kalinger News, list goes on. She has a popular program called Vanakkam Tamilagam on Sun TV over the last 15 years. So, with this introduction, may I invite Dr. Kousalya Nathan.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. And I thank Mr. Ramkumar for having me over this evening to be a part of this eminent gathering. So it's a pleasure to share some of the thoughts on lifestyle medicine and anti-aging, because this is some field which has been kind of, though widely known, and is known and unknown. So though we know a lot of things, it's very difficult when it comes to making it as a habit or practicing it on an everyday basis. So I've got a very brief presentation here for you, and I would be very happy to take questions once the presentation is over. So what is aging? So we all age. We are all programmed to age, and that we know. But what actually aging is? Why do we age? You know? So there are mainly three things associated with aging. One is the biological age, is the actual age. The number of candles you blow on your birthday is your actual age. You know, there is psychological aging, which I think has been triggered after 2020, COVID, where the psychological aging has been pushed ahead, especially in the Gen Z. That's not about, it's about the 16 years, 17, 18, that teenage, that children which actually were in that space of 2020, where COVID hit the globe. So that's a period where there is a lot of statistics which has come out saying, you know, there is a psychological push towards, you know, mental age, and a lot of anxiety and psychosomatic disorders have mushroomed in the last 3 years. So there's a chronological age. Chronological age is also a kind of the actual age. And when it comes to the internal age, which is the inner age of a person, which absolutely is something what we maintain ourselves for, you know. We can be 40 years, but from within, from inside, internally, mind, body, emotions, we can still be 10 years or 15 years younger than our actual age. So that's the whole age management is all about. We all learn to manage finance, so we do finance management. We learn to do home management, but there's something called health management. That's something predominantly taken over by disease care industry in the name of healthcare. But what is age management is all about? Proactive medicine, preventive approach towards a good quality of life with minimal medications or even nil medications. That's the whole idea or the goal of lifestyle medicine. And how we age. See, these are the few things which why we age and how we age. Aging is a multifactorial process. It is not a single factor. It's not about eating right or it's not about sleeping well. It's a many factors put together is what aging is all about. And when we talk about the molecular aspect of aging, there are multiple things which happen at the same time in a particular cell for it to kind of age in a particular way. So metabolic aging is about the metabolism which slows down as we age, we know. See, generally after 40, 45, it's very difficult to lose weight because the metabolism slows down. You know, the digestion slows down. People complain of constipation after 40, 45 because the digestive tract, the peristaltic movement in your gut slows down. So there is a lot of metabolic aging which naturally happens in our system as we age. It's programmed. For example, after 45, you all wear glasses. You know, nobody can actually be without. It's a program. Body is programmed where you get into some kind of, you know, where reading glasses we might need. There's a vision issue which can happen, which is physiological, you know, which is a kind of a normal process of aging. So it's very important to understand different kinds of the aging. Then endocrine aging. Endocrine, as we all know, like, you know, women hit menopause, you know, 45 and above, that's hormonal aging. And, you know, men also go through something called andropause, which happens some of them from 50, between 50 to 60, they go through the andropausal changes where the hormones dip and there is a weight gain and cardiac issue or hypertension and diabetes and all those kind of factors, endocrine. But now the concern is premature aging. So the generation when we see here, like between the age of around 15 to 25, there is premature aging. One of the very beautiful indicator of premature aging is the number of infertility centers which has mushroomed. It was not there 10 years before because fertility rate was good. So now the fertility rate has dipped is a very, very prominent sign to say how the generation has dipped or the aging process is accelerated and the quality of the endocrine function has dipped drastically. So that's a very clear indication that we see that, you know, the fertility rate is dipped predominantly to a larger extent where we need a lot of assistance to go through a normal natural conception process, which was very beautifully a natural phase, you know, 15, 20 years before. We never had this degree of, you know, the rate of infertility was this, never this high. So then about the mental aging. So mental aging, again, is a complex phenomena. This is the most difficult and the most complex evolving phenomena because mind is fluid. You cannot trap it. It's all over. It's everywhere. Or there's a, see, if everything goes well today, we are happy. If little from morning, if it starts raining or you feel your clothes are not ironed properly, as simple as the maid not coming on time, and it can be as simple as even the milkman coming late. Anything can trigger anxiety, you know. So it's like a everyday phenomena. So mental aging is a conscious effort that we really have to bring in to bring mindfulness in what we do. It's okay to be upset, but the mindfulness helps us to be faster in in getting ourselves back on track in a very faster space. So that's the mindfulness that we really have to kind of apply in our space when it comes to mental aging. And emotional aging, again, I think, you know, before 2020, in 2019, my presentation never had this as a concept of emotional aging. But in the last 5-6 years, I've seen in my clinical practice where emotions are directly proportionate to the number of, issues. In particular, I would say cancer. If there is a cancer issue, one of the main trigger factor, which has been published now in all international journals, including Lancet and British Medical Journal, is about, and particular interleukin kind of an inflammatory kind, cells which get triggered, inflammatory hormones and markers get triggered in your body. That's an emotional stress. So prolonged emotional stress can trigger you into kind of a very common inflammatory disease or disorder, complex thing, which is again cancer. We see it very common these days, become a very kind of an common factor, which was not so 10-15 years back. So this emotional aspect of aging is unaddressed. Nobody talks about it. Nobody, there's no discussion about it. They don't know which doctor to go to, how to open up, how to work on ourselves, how to get a closure, how to get a healing, how to work on our own. Because we're all, end of the day, it's a complex, human being is a complex phenomena, right? So we all made of mental health, emotional health, physical health, hormonal health, endocrine factors, all that. But then if you're busy going to different doctors, okay, mental health, we go to psychiatrist counseling, okay, fine, physical health, a physician, endocrinologist, gut health, a gastroenterologist. So we just kind of all over. But body is one. It's time to integrate it. I think we have segregated way too much, where each one is busy managing one particular system and then the other system is not taken care of. If there is a gut issue, it can also be a beginning from the mind. Internal stress can cause abundance of gastrointestinal system, disturb the complete system, the acid pH, from the acid pH to the mobility of the, the large and the small intestine, can be constipation. People who hold so much in the mind, stress in the mind, actually the common problem you see is constipation, because that's a kind of holding, it's not able to let go. So these are the factors where mind body is interconnected. We all know those days, we used to say straight from the gut, right? So the gut, the mind and the gut are interrelated. And as we all know about, the genes, like we are all unique in our own ways. So the gut has the good bacteria, the bad bacteria is unique in each one of us. It's not the same. Same when it comes to skin, has good bacteria and bad bacteria. It is not the same. We're all different in our own ways. My flora is different from yours, and each one of us have a different flora. That is the reason where I think the same soap may cause dryness in one person, the same shower gel can actually, the reaction of as simple as a body shower gel can be different in different individuals, because our whole system of our, the bacteria, the flora and the fauna is very different. And same with when it comes to the vaginal health as well. So vaginal flora and fauna, very different from individual, and it's hormonally influenced as well. So what I'm trying to tell you here is body is one. Body is not multiple things like, okay, it's so much happening. No, it may be so much happening, but it's all interconnected. If you feel hungry, why we feel anxious? We are restless. Mind is disturbed. It starts even from a baby, starts crying when it feels hungry, right? So that it is anxious. It behaves very differently. It becomes cranky if the baby is hungry. Even it holds good, not just for children, but even for us. Even we feel hungry, we get disturbed, we get angry, or we are upset, So what I'm saying is, see the connection between as simple as a hunger, which is a very normal, natural phenomenon of a gastrointestinal system, to the behavior for a normal change which happens in the gut. You see so much of a behavioral change that we have noticed. So it's very important for us to understand that it is one, they're all interconnected, and some of them have irritable bowel syndrome. So that's an anxiety issue. If you have anxiousness and anxiety issue, there is a pituitary gland, we all know, in the brain, base of the brain. The pituitary, the axis that we call, gets disturbed, then it can actually affect the gut. You have irritable gut, or we call it leaky gut, or it can be bloating, or it can be any form of such thing. So the interconnection between emotions, metabolic health, aging, endocrine, all that is all happening in the cell at the same time. So we have to look at everything as one, to have a long-term solution or a permanent solution, or have a very constructive way of looking at health as one. And social aging. See, what happens is socially, the aging process is triggered. For example, we have a group of people who walk, like our friends walk. So we are motivated, right? So we, on the other side, we have a group of friends who party every weekend and they kind of eat junk foods, and our health also would kind of translate into what that whole group is. So social aging is very important. Now recently, WHO, I think, you know, in 2021 declared that someone who's socially active and healthy, they are the most healthiest people in the world. It's not about eating, right? It's not about meditating. It's not about the emotional part. It's about the social aging, because we are all social beings. Why the degree of, you know, the percentage of mental health and anxiety in different generations has just bottled up to, it's come to a very big problem today during COVID, because we are socially cut. In all space, we're socially cut. We were all restricted to one kind of, under one roof, in a very small, we're cooped in every space, right? Because we're cooped for 6 months to 8 months, you know, that it was enough to bring out so much of psychological issues in us. So imagine the role of social health in us. This doesn't mean that it's social media, like we are in social media, we are on Facebook, on Instagram, or in, you know, YouTubes and all those kind of things, which is an, I think, I feel it's a kind of an, you know, technical junk, if I may say so. But we here we are talking about live interactions. See, the we have, it's about sharing, giving, caring, looking up, getting inspired, motivation, motivating each other. So I think that's the strength of the social health and the social well-being. That's very important when it comes to social aging, because we have a peer group with which we age together, right? So we age together. That's a very beautiful feeling of, you know, sharing and caring. So it's very important to understand that aging is complex. It's a multiple phenomena, and it's important to look at body as one. And please, we'll have to address in all these aspects of endocrine or metabolic or mental age to have a healthy living, or to have a very progressively and healthy aging, you know, curve. So healthy aging versus premature aging. Today's problem is premature aging. You know, we're all aging prematurely than our ancestors, or than our parents or grandparents. My grandmother lived till 100. You know, she died exactly when she turned, the day she turned 100. But she never had blood pressure, she never had diabetes or obesity or any gut issue, or, you know, she had full hair, except for it had turned white, but, you know, her skin was good, no pigmentation. See, the quality of life was so good, where I think she never was holding anything in her. That was a very beautiful. She would just let go and nothing mattered. Only simple things mattered to her was whether did you eat it, eat food on time, or you sleep on time, and then switch off. She was not worrying about things which probably, you know, we all overthink and worry about. So it's very important to understand about healthy aging and premature aging. See, now the responsibility in all of us is to take charge of aging, is to make sure that we don't age prematurely. Premature aging is like, now we see girls with polycystic ovarian syndrome is a common problem. So PCOS, when it's a common problem, fertility rate is reducing, because the ovaries have already kind of not healthy. Ovaries are already having issues, cysts are there, and hormonally, mood swings, irritability, hair fall, hair growth in the upper lip and the chin, and then, you know, gaining weight around the waist area and losing weight on the, you know, the front of the hair, pigmentation, and then you have insulin, hyperinsulinemia, obesity, snoring, you know, all mood swings, irritability, all that. Now, all that which was normal is now needs a lot of attention. Simple as PMS. Now, PMS meaning premenstrual stress, right? I'm sure all of us in our generation, still when you have periods, you still have some kind of a discomfort, or a lower abdomen pain, or tiredness, or a back pain, or a leg pain. But it was never an issue that which needs like a medical attention. Now, PMS is something become very common word, and they all feel that you have to be attended and given attention to, cared for, and you know, now it's slowly becoming like a disorder or like a disease, whereas it was otherwise a very physiological and a natural process of a girl menstruating. So things have changed when it comes to mind, emotions, body, metabolism, hormones, and every sphere. So aging healthy is very important. So what are the symptoms which says premature aging? Could be early hypertension, less than 40. If there is hypertension, there's early hypertension. Then hyperinsulinemia is where you see increased levels of insulin levels. Like the symptoms could be discoloration in your neck, underarm, you know, and then pigmentation, sudden weight gain, and appetite is increased. You know, these are could be the signs of hyperinsulinemia. And then you make, you know, hair thinning, and you know, lack of sleep, and elevated inflammatory markers, as I told you, these are the signs of, you know, early premature aging. If the inflammatory markers are high, it can be a pro condition for diabetes, pro condition for arthritis, pro condition for, you know, cardiac problem, pro condition for even cancer. So I think these are the pro markers. But why I am insisting here to look into the pro markers is they are reversible. Once you see it's a slight elevation in all these inflammatory things in your cells, and if you identify it with good lifestyle medicine and practice, you can actually reverse it, which is a beautiful phenomena when it comes to, you know, aging per se. So lowered immunity is a very common problem, because catching cold and cough and sneezing and just one kind of change in the weather causes a lot of disturbance in our respiratory system, because the lungs have become not stronger than before. You know that there is a dip in the respiratory function. So again, we have this, a lot of changes when it comes to joint health. Diabetes is a big problem now. Sleep apnea is another issue. Pre-diabetic and obesitis. So let me explain just 1 minute about obesity and obesitis. See, my whole paper, my PhD was on obesitis. See, where you have overweight, we know is a problem. Overweight, obesity, grade 1, 2, 3. That's how we segregate, you know, the overweight for medical evaluation. So when you have simple overweight, and if your inflammatory markers are high, as I was mentioning about inflammatory markers, like where there's an inflammation in your system and the blood is releasing some kind of markers or some inflammatory blood cytokines which goes high, so we need to pick it up, because that's a disorder, that's a disease by itself which needs attention. Because obesity is not about being chubby or not about, you know, being on a heavier side, it's about a disorder or a disease which can cause multiple issues. If there is someone who have overweight and have the inflammatory markers high, there's a very high chance they go into sleep apnea, which is a snoring issue, or it can be, you know, again, you know, cardiac issues, heart attacks, or ischemic heart problem, or hypertension, or diabetes, any of the lifestyle disorders, and including, you know, cancer. So it's very important to identify that. And again, sleep disorders, there's a lot of anxiety, and the quality of sleep in the last 4 years as per the statistics has come down by 20%. In a post-COVID, the quality of sleep has come down by 20%, whereas they see there is a lot of personality which has come up. Like there are a lot of hidden, some personality of us is shown to us, known to us, but there are some hidden personalities which are there, which also came out during this COVID period, that has caused a lot of disharmony in the mental health of people. And it is important to understand about early menarche and early menopause. Early menarche, at the age of 8, 10, you see menarche, children attaining puberty. You know, that's also early sign of premature aging. And early menopause I see in the clinic these days. Women having ovarian failure or having early menopausal symptoms less than 45 years of age is again an early menopause. When they attain early menopause, they need medical care and attention. We can't brush it off saying menopause is normal, it's physiological, you got to go through it. No, it's such a chaos that they go through a lot of changes happen in their body and mind and emotions. They just feel low, the confidence level goes down, there is a hair fall, skin kind of changes, or weight gain, weight loss, sleep issue, hot flushes, vaginal dryness, so many things which they go through needs medical help and attention. And it is preferably, if it's done in an integrative fashion, looking at handling the emotional health, mental health, the nutritional aspect and all of it, sleep, to give them a holistic view or an integrated way of bringing them a positive outlook towards the early menopause concept, you know. So that's very important. And gastrointestinal disorders, again, in the last 4 years, there is a tremendous increase in the gastrointestinal disorders by 30 to 35% globally. It's again related to the COVID aspect from 2020 because of the mental health. When the mental health gets disturbed, it affects your gastrointestinal health as well. It can be prolonged stress, chronic stress, or it can be sleep issue, anxiety, anger, suppressed anger, or it can be, you know, job stress or balancing work life, anything, you know, it can cause, you know, changes when it comes to gastrointestinal, you know, disorders. And if there is a gastrointestinal disorder, I recommend, I suggest that there is a dental care done too. It is very important that, because I think the oral health is very important, because there's a very different flora fauna, good bacteria, bad bacteria in the mouth is very different. The esophagus has got a different kind of combination of, you know, good and the bad bacteria. Then the stomach has different, you know, concept of its own harmony. Then large intestine is very different, small intestine is different, and the anal region is all very, very different. So it's important to take care of your oral health. If there is a prolonged GERD issue or a reflux issue, or there has been one kind of an, you know, gastrointestinal disorders. Okay, now the statistics, of course, says that, you know, job strain increases mortality risk, which is predominantly related to cardiovascular disease. So how to prevent cardiovascular disease? First is, I think, exercise. I think exercise is like, you know, if you don't exercise, it's worse than smoking. The effect of it on your body can be worse than the effect it can have as when you smoke. So it's important to kind of focus on exercise, though we know it's not something that we don't know, but implementation is where the problem lies. So some atomic habits, the small habits that we slowly kind of start, it can be walking in the house, or 15 minutes a day, or 20 minutes a day, or it can be yoga, or any form of physical activity really is very important in taking care in preventing, you know, cardiovascular diseases. So yeah, I think you can't do a good job if your job is all you do. So I think all of us do only a job most of the time, but it's important to have a balance of work life, because somewhere down the line, if that's work completely consumes us, we become a workaholic, it takes a toll on our health. It can be hypertension, sleep issue, and multiple psychosomatic disorders, including heart attacks. It's a very common thing when it comes to when we fail to have a work-life balance. So anti-aging lifestyle is positive mental attitude towards a change in lifestyle, and assessing. It's important to assess your aging. See, assessing your aging could be your muscle, your bone health, your mineral health, your nutrition, your deficiencies, your gut health, your mental aging, your emotional aspect. It's all completely in different aspect of the being we need to evaluate when it comes to aging, so that from there we can actually take it from there to work on helping them in a progressive positive impact on recovery. So medical lifestyle assessment that we do, and nutritional assessment, stress evaluation, emotional health evaluation, obesity evaluation, endocrine aging, anxiety and internal stress evaluation, which is a psychological aging assessment, is very important. Post sleep hygiene, I think that's something, I think the generation, the next generation is a worrisome generation, especially from the age of 13 to, I think, 25, I would say, because I think their whole system in the last 4 years is completely glued on into technology, whether it's a laptop or a mobile phone or iPad or tablets or whatever it may be. They believe whatever they see in it. But unfortunately, 80 to 90% of what you get in that is absolutely is a complete, you know, junk kind of an, you know, thing. That's what you have in the social media, because everybody have a page and all of them talk about mental health. Everyone talks about diet and nutrition and this, that, and, you know, it's become a very a place where there's the generation thinks Instagram, if it comes, it's ultimate truth. If somebody is selling a protein powder in Instagram and that guy has n number of followers, this is what my son comes and shows to me. See, he has got this much of followers and you want to tell me, don't take this, don't take that's not good. If it is not good, why would he have this many followers? You know, see, the influence of how the number of followers or the influencers, as it rightly named as, I think has got a very great impact on the impressive age of this generation, where they take it way too seriously. They believe in what they see. If that man has got a six pack, they believe he really is work hard to get the six pack. He might have even used a filter to have all that, for all we know. So we don't know. They are from different walks of life, different countries, time zones, and the way they promote themselves. And they're all paid promotions, where some people, influencers do paid promotions for selling some kind of a protein powder or any gym equipment. But people get carried away with such stuff, especially the next generation. They believe in it, because I think they got so much hooked on to it, into that phase of social media, where they find it very difficult and they believe that's right. So that's where we are in when it comes to social media addiction, if I may say so. In NIMHANS, I think last year they've opened a department for social media addiction. So recovery, addiction recovery or de-addiction center of social media. So that means that's become a real actually issue per se. And digital detox, I think we all have to create our own digital detox. I think we don't have to run away from, phones or from iPads, but we can constructively use the digitalization for our productivity. It can be listening to audiobooks. We can't read, but at least we can use it to listen to audiobooks, or we can actually listen to music to unwind ourselves, or, watch something creative and try something creative with it, or read a novel, or somebody to read a novel. Some form of it, it's very important. And there should be some phase where cutoff time that we really have to give our self to kind of detox. Otherwise, without our knowledge, the Insta goes on. You can go on for your life with it, because it's just like a one swap thing, this way, that way, or upward, and that's what it is. And the whole change in the drift in the way people think and the mindset which is changed is alarmingly concerned when it comes to health issues. Yeah, so invest in yourself is by taking care of yourself. So invest your time in taking care of yourself. So choose prevention over cure. We all want to, we all know, but we all try, and somewhere I think, we don't know the right path, how to take care of ourselves when it comes to prevention. I think preventive medicine and proactive medicine is what is the future, and many hospitals are now thinking in this line of having a preventive and a proactive medicine kind of a facility and department. So first is to improve the awareness. I think it's very important to bring in awareness in the mind and body of an individual, and a proactive approach. The proactive approach is a very positive approach towards prevention of so many diseases and disorders. And think, body is one. Body is not this many doctors. Body is one. It is interconnected. You sleep well, you wake up fresh. The whole day you have less anxiety, the whole day the productivity is good, your digestion is good, you're able to concentrate better, you have a good day, So it's very important, body is one. So it's very important to think integrated, bring it as one. Two main systems which govern the body. One in the front is the gastrointestinal system, back is the brain and the spinal cord, right? So these, the nervous system and the gastrointestinal system, helps us to keep the oneness in us. So make sure that when it comes to brain, I'm talking about mental health, emotional health as well, and the neurological health. When it comes to gut, it's about the gastrointestinal system, which is the most important thing, because that's the system which breaks down one idli and gives you all the energy to run your day. So that gastrointestinal system, it cannot be replaced at all. So it's very important to take care of it. And skin and disease care to healthcare. Yeah, it's very important to think that, so far we were thinking that healthcare actually is healthcare, but so far, what we have been doing is healthcare has only been disease care. You know, it has not been actually preserving health. It's about treating diseases. Concerns, infections and inflammations, then you get admitted, you fall sick and then you take care. But it's time that we really think of, you know, healthcare, you know, and preserve yourself. Today, I'm sure how many of you are non-diabetic. I'm a non-diabetic. Preserve it. Preserve it. You're a non-diabetic today. How many of you here think, okay, I'm non-hypertensive, I don't have hypertension? Preserve it. Find out a way how you can actually be this, where you can actually not, your blood pressure is under normal, and what steps I'll have to take as I age to make sure that I don't, you know, become hypertension, right? You're gifted. We're all gifted, like we don't have a diabetes or we don't have hypertension or we don't have a cardiac problem, we don't have cancer or we don't have obesity or we don't have. So preserve it. If you don't have that, preserve it. So maybe you may have one issue. For example, you may be diabetic, but you're not hypertension, right? Preserve it. Preserve what you don't have. You've got something, manage it very well. Medicine is not the only way to manage. If medicine has to cure everything, I think we all would be disease-free, because we are all having medicines, and pharmaceutical industry is so huge and it's growing and so big. But that pharmaceutical industry in 2020, in this 20th generation, could box the whole world inside our house without knowing how to handle a small and microorganism, invisible, scary one, which is COVID, right? So if medicine was to cure everything and there was a solution to everything, like problem, if medicine is to take care of all your health needs, I think as small as an antiviral, we couldn't battle it, right? It was a struggle. Still, it's not yet over. Still different kinds of, you know, viruses and, you know, different kinds of issues are still cropping up. So it's important to understand that, okay, there are medicines. Medicines are there for a reason. If I fall sick, I'll take the medications and I'll be okay. It's a wrong attitude. And if you think, okay, fine, I have money and then I can take care and I can have so many people to take care of me. And even if I'm unmanaged diabetic, tomorrow my kidney may go, so big deal. I will buy kidney from somebody, or somebody will donor, and then I'll be okay. It's all wrong conception. There are few people who come and even tell me, one life, let me live the way I want to, big deal. And then one day, anyway, all of us are going to die. That's again a very pathetic attitude, sorry to say. You know, because I think somewhere down the line, it's not about we dying. All of us have come with a return ticket. Only thing is we don't know when it is, right? That's not the point. But the quality of life of us is going to disturb our state. It's disturb our family and it's going to disturb the society as well. In all angles, we become a burden to our family, the society, and enlarge the globe, right? So it's very important that, you know, it's a responsibility to take care of our own health and, you know, to a large, to whatever we can, you know. That's a very important thing for us to understand and take help early. Most of the time when we have, for example, snoring, people think it's normal. So we don't have to take help. Snoring is not normal. If you have snoring, we got to address it. It can be a sinusitis, it could be reflux issues, or it could be obesity or abdominal weight, which is kind of increased. So you can't be saying, oh, okay, I have snoring, that's normal. No. And if there is a recurrent sneezing, it could be allergic sneezing, address it. Don't say, okay, I've been sneezing for the last 10 years, it's okay to sneeze. No. Because that sneezing, which is chronically there is a disturbance in your nasal health, and it can slowly affect your lung and your breathing, especially the upper respiratory tract, you know, when it comes to the upper lobe. So don't try to normalize certain small things which has been there for a long time affecting your quality of life. Address early. So that's very important. And be well at work. So this is, again, all of us know, emotional support and peaceful, you know, lives, practical lifestyle solution. So these are the few things which we can actually help each other in getting our system or our wellness intact, you know. So stay connected with your friends, family. So these are small things. So again, this is the thing where well-being is about exercise and learning and development. So till we die, it's important to learn. It can be anything. So have a schedule, like in this year I'm going to learn this and see if you can do that. So that learning new skill every year keep our brain, and it prevents us from Alzheimer's and also to a certain extent Parkinsonism. So if you learn something new thing every year, it really helps in the neurons to kind of stay intact. So keep yourself, and relaxation is important. I think we all, without our knowledge, because of the deep rooted emotional traumas, deep rooted mental health, unaddressed issues, we all end up having, you know, a lot of this stress issues, and stress again has an impact on the whole health, you know. So, and relationships, so important. So at CALM, we work on preventive and proactive approach. It's early detection and reversal. It's all personalized program and overall health, molecular aspect of aging, quality of life with minimal medication, environmental health. Yeah. Again, environmental health is important. Let's start with our own kitchen. At least stop using plastic plates to eat. You know, plastic tumblers in your house. You know, non-stick tawas is dangerous. It's carcinogenic, by the way. It's cancer inducing. So stop it. That research was done by my cousin only in John Hopkins. So the first thing she kind of came and told all of us, just stop it, you know. So because that causes a lot of this, the repeated heating of it on that Teflon coating, and the more it gets released over a period of time, causes dangerous effect on the system. So not worth it. So what I mean by environmental health is not about the plants and the trees, but it's about your kitchen. Start from your home, the kitchen and the home and home environment. Keep it a little less toxic as much as possible, you know, and that's very important. Overall health, concentrate on overall health, you know, that's very important. Molecular aspect of aging and quality of life and environmental health, customizing menus. Yeah, again, food is a very vast thing. You can eat, there's nothing called diet. My PhD was on that, where I just said diet doesn't work. Sorry to say, diet doesn't work. Don't diet, eat well. So eat right according to your body type. You have to enjoy what you eat, you know. It may be different for different people. Like diabetic, they may like gulab jamun, but they can't be eating gulab jamun every day, right? But some replacement they would get. If you have a sweet tooth, there are healthier options which you can choose for. So make that shift. Make that change, which comes from extreme kind of an tongue, the taste to a normalcy. For example, the minute we ask, name some sweets. Okay, name something sweet. Okay, let me put it correctly. Name something sweet. The first thing what comes to us would be what? Ram Kumar sir was distributing kaju katlis to everybody. So I'm going to give him some options from next time. Maybe I think I'll give you some contact. Maybe you can try. See if that can actually be brought into it. Some small change. I've come here. Maybe if that can be something as small as that, I'll be very happy. So see, what I'm saying is kaju katli. See, what I'm saying is I'm not trying to this thing, but what I'm trying to tell you is the minute we say name some sweets would be something sweet. First thing, gulab jamun, kaju katli. Okay, and rasagulla, badam halwa, mouth-watering, is it? No, what I'm saying is, nobody thought of a mango and an apple or a banana. Is banana bitter? Banana is sweet. Mangoes. But nobody would think of it. You know why? We have conditioned ourselves over a period of time to think that way. Even in your biology papers in second standard, name three sweets means we'll have to write gulab jamun only. Nobody will accept the answer. Name three fruits, we can write banana, mango and oranges. But we cannot write, no, the whole thing is shift. We need to. And we have conditioned our tongue for a sweetness of a particular degree. Otherwise, the tongue doesn't accept it as a sweetness. If you stop eating sugar for around 1 month and then you kind of eat dates, for example, or a fig, or it can be any raisins, you'll find it too sweet. You can't have more than one, you know, if you stop it. Because the tongue degree of the Mysore Pak sweetness is brought down in the 1 month. The degree is brought down to appreciate the natural sweetness in fruits, you know. All carrot also sweet, beetroot also sweet, potato also sweet. So, but the sweetness in it, for example, if you don't want to accept potato and carrot as sweet, at least let's accept dates and figs and, you know, raisins, black raisins and, you know, all those dry fruit laddus and all that, you know, jaggery, palm sugar, palm jaggery, all that is a form of sweetness, you know. And, you know, this chickies and then, you know, dry fruit bars, almond, you know, almond jaggery based burfis that you get. So many options are available now when it comes to sweet tooth. So it's very important to understand and make that awareness shift, which is very important. And customizing menus is, again, I feel it's vast. And in India, we are blessed. We have so many cuisines, whether it's vegetarian or non-vegetarian, nobody can beat our country. I'm sure you will agree with me, you know. So it's very important that we make the best out of it. But whereas we are very busy looking for Moroccan food or Japanese sushi or Italian, so we want to gallivant new stuff. But, you know, the world, the Western people, and WHO is declaring idli as one of the most healthiest food in the world. They are busy copying us. And I think in 2017, when I was in the United States for a keynote address speaker on nutrigenomics and nutrigenetics, I was a second speaker. The first speaker before me was also talking about curcumin. The first slide he put, he's an American, and the first slide he had put was, Indian curries have the high antioxidant. I said, wow, meaning what am I sitting here and doing? I should be giving that presentation, not that gentleman, not with due respect to the scientist who did it. I felt we use it every day. You know, sambar is part of everyday menu. Curcumin, turmeric has been, I mean, we never got so deep to find out, but that's part of our everyday stuff. Now people are isolating it, making research, publishing, and then they will have packed sambar made in USA coming here, and we would just say, wow. Like how it happened with the baby foods. What's happening with the baby foods now? I see the next generation kind of people coming into the clinic, and then, you know, newly married and the first child, and within 1 year they don't know what to give. Can I give that packed thing, apple, mashed apple, which is imported from US, is what they want to give. The rice thing, which comes from different countries, they send, the husband is traveling abroad, so she gives a big list of the food that the husband can bring for the child. That's the system which is going when it comes to next generation, right? Whereas they are very busy talking about curcumin, sambar, and the vegetable it has got, the tamarind it has, and then, you know, the turmeric in it. So all that put together. So what I'm trying to tell you is, experimentation, keep it only 15 to 20%. I'm telling you, when it comes to food. Because we cannot be genetically compatible to Moroccan food or Italian pizzas. We are not. Let's be black and white there. Okay, we are Indian genes. Our body can do well with idlis, dosas, pongals, khichdis, pohas or whatever, or chapatis or fulkas. But we cannot be doing well with so much with maidas and, you know, the burger or, you know, all those kind of deep fried and French fries and all that. No. Okay, and we are not used to so much of raw meat as well. You know, that's not been in our system. So it's very important that at least 80% keep it to your basics. Respect your genes. Keep your system basic to the lifestyle that your ancestors have had or you have end up growing or your environment eats. Like if you live in Mumbai, you have to make sure that the environment, what it has, you should. If you're in Nagpur, follow that, because they use a lot of jowar there, you know, only one particular. Here, it's predominantly could be rice is grown here. We don't have so much of wheat in this state grown, right? But still, we want to have chapatis, and then we again have gut issues, or we can't metabolize it. So somewhere, we need to understand that we need to live. If 10 years you've lived in one place, the system changes, especially the gastrointestinal system. You may be, a Punjabi from somewhere, settled down, for example, in Chennai or in Coimbatore. But then your gut in the last 10, 15 years has gone through so much of changes with this kind of this region's food, right? So it's important to understand how we need to work on your gut health and the intestinal health to make sure that the absorption is brilliant and you need only less vitamin supplements. People ask me, you are the one who don't write supplements. I said, if you can eat well, your dental health is good, you can afford good food. You know, supplements should be only 10-15% of your, after 45 maybe, after 50 maybe, right? Or maybe for a short period of time till you recover or recuperate or the deficiencies are replenished. That's about it. Not like one centrum you take, lifelong you keep taking centrums, you know? And people coming from US, children, they bring only that because they think they're taking care of the parents by giving Centrum. So I think we need to really have a mental shift to understand clarity about nutrition and supplements and basic health. We are leaving the core of our basic health and trying to, you know, bring supplements and chemicals so much into it, likingly or knowingly or unknowingly. It's important that the awareness comes. So again, taking care of the complete, you know, aspects of all aspects of being is very important. And lifestyle disorders that we do is diabetes, obesity, sleep apnea, GERD issues, and, you know, coronary artery diseases and mind emotions related reactions, body reactions. To see, again, one more thing I want to talk. There's a lot of autoimmune diseases today. The main reason is emotional health. Let's not kind of leave the emotional health. Emotional health is family, relations, friends. So make sure that you take care of your family well so that the emotional health is good. And you take care of your friends well so that the emotional health is good. So focus on that. That's the core. That's the core of your well-being, you know. So to prevent a lot of diseases and migraine and infertility as well. So again, these, again, we also specialize in post-bariatric, post-bypass surgery, post-liposuction, post-lifestyle, post-hysterectomy, post-infertility and post-cancer and chemotherapies. We do extensively lifestyle management program and post-knee joint replacement. And the care, the basic care, if somebody wants to have some take-home message from here. So jeera water is one thing excellent for our, you know, gut health. And choose milk wisely. See, not everybody can digest milk, because not like milk is bad or I hate milk or I don't like milk. We all have literally grown up having milk, but over a period of time, the packet milk that we get is not actually milk. How can a milk be in the refrigerator without getting spoiled for 3 days? How? Sorry? Of course, yes. To top it all, in a plastic bag as well, we freeze it. See, okay, you make orange juice in your house. Right? Homemade orange juice. For how many hours you think it'll be good? 1 hour. Maybe if you're, okay, let's keep 2 hours. How come when you buy an orange juice tetra pack for 3 months and they say nothing added in it, everything is perfect in it or done, how is it? You open it, you drink. It's not like you open and then you can keep it for 3 months, right? How is it? So the minute it comes in a packet or in a dabba, or it's in a bottle, some human being has touched it. Beware. It's not from nature. It's not from nature. It's someone has touched it. Beware. Okay, so as much as possible, connect to nature, natural foods, homemade foods, fresh foods is the best way to take care of your basic needs. Yeah. So again, choose food over medicines. Yes. Food can heal so many things. As simple as small changes, it can heal is the right word. It's not treat, it will heal. If you have a gastric ulcer, if you make changes in the food, the ulcer heals. There's a healing which can happen. It's beautiful. So it's very important for us to understand and respect it. Probably that's the reason father of medicine, Hippocrates, said, food is medicine, medicine is food. But we all know. But we couldn't, even while I was studying, I couldn't feel it. I knew it, I wrote it in my theory papers maybe, but I have to feel it, right, to know what it is. Yes, that's actually the truth. But it takes long time for us to kind of, you know, feel that aspect. And lifestyle is the key to longevity. You want to live long, live well. So lifestyle is the basic thing. That's nothing but discipline. Discipline is destiny is a new book I'm reading. I love it. It's nice. Discipline is destiny. It's beautiful. So I think that's a fact. So let's not go too off that and try to make some small changes in our system to bring in some positive changes. Choose food over medicines. Yeah, periodic checkup is important. Balance your plate. Yeah, this is something you may be interested. 60% carbohydrate, 20% protein, 20% fat. All right. There is nothing called zero carb diet to lose weight. You can eat rice. You can eat good food, rice and vegetables, and lose weight. Okay, it's not like people think if I eat rice, I'll become fat. It's not good for my diabetic or it's not good for my gut. It's a myth. You can actually eat rice and then you will have a good digestive tract and you will lose weight as well. So 20% can be protein, 20% has to be fat. You need fat to look young. You want to look young? Eat fat. There's nothing called zero. Zero fat diet, myth. Zero, what high protein diet, that high and zero, be aware of it. Never get into it. That's a diet itself is wrong. But if somebody is saying we go into zero oil diet, no, sorry. If it's going to be high protein diet, no, please don't. Don't go into anything called high protein. Have a balanced diet. That balance is different from each one of us. A diabetic will have a different balance. Somebody who wants to lose weight will have a different balance. Somebody has gotten, you know, any procedure or a surgery done, they will have a different balance. Each one of us balance will be very different. But predominantly, we need to have carbohydrate to have less anxiety. Otherwise, where is energy coming from? From the steroids, from the cortisol. Your stress hormones will be pushing you to work. It's not, energy should come from food, right? It won't come from food. Instead, it will be coming from the stress that produces, the body produces. So beware of it. So eat well. And health is wealth. We all know it. You know, health is wealth because we can't buy, you know, we can't put a price to a body. You know, how much is the liver price? It came free of cost. So maybe we are not maintaining because of it. Eyes, there is a value to it. Heart is priceless. Or, you know, we have only one uterus. We have only one stomach. So we need to really take care of our health in a very, you know, in a loving way. Love yourself to take care of yourself. And learn something new. I think I already said that. So thank you so much for this, for attention. And thanks for this opportunity, Mr. Ramkumar. And thank you, sir. You've come with the family to be part of this. Thank you so much. Any questions that...
Two questions I'd like to raise with you. First is, and this, I'd like your response to a particular argument I hear from my medical colleagues who say that we are genetically determined. You did mention genes. And your grandmother lived to be 100 because of favorable genetics. And therefore, there's not much we can do to improve our situation. And that's the conclusion I hear from some of my medical colleagues. A second one is diet. You did say in your presentation that diet won't help, right? I come from a society, Australia, which has an acute obesity problem. And it seems, I think many people stress the point that some kind of diet is necessary because of very poor nutritional standards. So what's your view of that?
Okay.
I noticed that obesity is not a big problem in India, but it's certainly a problem in Western societies.
Yeah. All right. Thank you so much for your question. So first, I take your first question and give you a clarification here. I think there is enough evidence and publication to say that, you know, aging can be regulated through your genes by following especially calorie restriction. Since 1931, from McKay is the name of the scientist who worked on it. In this 75 years in this field, if you can go and if you want, I can give you references as well. So there is a proven way where food has got an impact, food and nutrients totally has got an impact on the genetic aspect. Yes, I agree with the point that we all have come. For example, 1 out of 3 is a diabetic. Very clearly, let us say India is a pro-diabetic country. All of us are prone to diabetes in India. There are no exceptions. Genetically, I'm saying. But what is triggering? Everybody becomes a diabetic. What triggers is your lifestyle, your food you eat, your smoking or your lack of physical activity, your sedentary lifestyle is the trigger part. Here we are talking about the triggering part. If you can maintain your genes well by eating the right food, there is a possibility. You may not, for example, if you have, your father had diabetic at 80, why is it that you will have to have it at 60? If genetically everything copy print, your blueprint is right, you should also get only at around 80, right? So that's not the fact. There are more issues or there are more factors, multi-factors of lifestyle. It could be stress or lack of sleep or food or high calorie foods or the nutrition has not been sufficient where the genes are triggered. So accelerated. So when you accelerate it, then the replication of it or how the genes behave will be different. So that's the part which I like to clarify. And obesity here in India, we are globally on number 3. Sir, I think we are not any less when it comes to think we are also kind of have issues with obesity. In fact, our childhood obesity is on a very alarming rise where I think the government is making a lot of you know, regulations to regulate that bit of childhood obesity as well. So main thing, and again you mentioned about the diet, why I'm mentioning that, you know, the diet word I don't use, because it's been misused quite a bit. The minute you say you have to be on a diet, the person gets stressed. Oh, some restriction. I'm telling you, I've been practicing for 25 years. I stopped using the word diet because patients used to come to me and tell me, doctor, I'm going to come and see you today. So yesterday I went to the best of the restaurant, had the maximum food possible because I know for sure from today I have to be on a diet. I said, no, the word has been misunderstood or it's gone into the mind of people in a different way. I didn't want to use it. So I say right eating pattern. Why should somebody be scared of coming to me? They should love to come to me. That was my idea, right? They should look forward to seeing me. That's the whole idea of my practice, of me talking about proactive medicine, preventive medicine, emotional health, all that I talk about, and then somebody is scared of coming to see me and I give them white collar hypertension. So I just said, leave it. If that word is causing so much of it, that's my personal thing, sir. It's not about the global concept of health. It's my personal thing with my experience. I don't put anybody on a diet. They have to eat well. You have to eat balanced way. So you have a plate and my measurements are simple. Plate, now anyways, people take food in tiffin boxes, so tiffin box or a plate. Your eyes, your hands, that's it. I'm not going to talk any theories here, fundas here. I didn't put any diet pyramid here. In my presentation, I never showed any pyramid. I don't believe in it. Make it flat. Make it flat. We have banana leaf food and what am I talking about in a pyramid here? Can't relate to it. We have been eating banana food and there's the most healthiest way of eating in a banana leaf. That's what we are used to in Indian scenario. So I have no kind of thing. I'm very proud. And let me kind of educate people or bring that system back into them which has been disturbed by the westernization, unfortunately. So that's the idea and that's what I meant when I said, you know, diet, it's my personal thing. Of course, globally, people talk about the word diet a lot. I personally have given it up a long time back. Thank you.
Yes, please.
I have one little question.
Sure.
Your plate? You've had 60-20-20, 60% carbohydrates, 20 protein, 20 fats. Where are the vegetables?
Carbohydrates are vegetables. See, there are complex carbohydrates and simple carbohydrates. Simple carbohydrate is the rice and the wheat and the grains that you have. The complex carbohydrate are the fruits and the vegetables. So we don't relate to vegetables and fruits as carbohydrates, but they are complex carbohydrates.
Hi. No.
Let's accept the fact. When I was growing up, my mother was a homemaker. 24/7, I had my mother with me. That separation anxiety I never had in my life. So I can walk in suddenly. I think I remember once Indira Gandhi was assassinated, so I had to go home. School suddenly declared holiday. I didn't have to think where the key will be, who will be at home, will there be food, nothing. I just walk home, right? But now, I think parents also have their own, you know, they do their own stuff. So children find their own way to grab their attention. And this is one of the way where they get their monthly attention, you know. So that's one of it. And of course, yes, I think the nutrition per se in the soil is depleted, you know, and environmentally a lot of changes, stress. Also, they have their own stress because all sudden then they are living in a real world, right? That's how much of stress, imagine. That's full of anxiety only. Open it, it's only anxiety which is there, you know. So they also have their own anxiety issues. They also have their own peer group issues, girlfriend, boyfriend issues. So they also go through their own set of confusions and anxieties which was not there when we kind of grew up. And most importantly, children hardly read. Nobody touches a book, right? The knowledge is from the books, all said and done. You know, we have removed that from them and replaced laptop. So the knowledge has become very superficial or very, very mild. They don't know the real depth of any information. They just want to follow some Instagram influencer, some YouTuber. Now YouTuber, oh, he's, my son tells me, oh, that's a career by itself. You don't know how much he's making. YouTuber is a fact. I mean, what he says is a fact. YouTuber. See, when we never grew up, visualizing ourselves, idealizing somebody, maximum you would have idealized was maybe Hema Malini or Rekha, or that too, not because we want to become an actress. It's about the way the gracefulness in them as a woman, or Amitabh Bachchan's, that's what we all would have, would have absorbed. But the generation is into absorbing junk completely. And with junk, there is money. With junk, there is so much junk, meaning, I mean, even food junk. You know, even all these packeted foods or junk foods are also a lot of business, right? The ads, the interesting ads, their favorite, cricket star coming in, or the favorite heroes, heroines coming in. So it's a market which has become completely a real world issue. So I think it's both aspects of hormonal and, environmental. Yes, please.
You know, there is the good, bad and ugly in every system of practice in the context of our times.
True.
So we have to be discretionary in taking the best and letting go of what is not good.
True, absolutely.
Now again, talking about, what you're born with, the problems genetically. There is now we talk about epigenetics. It's
correct.
Not just your genes. You may have the potential.
True.
But not get the disease because of your healthy lifestyle.
Correct.
And the other way around.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
So genetics, epigenetics going together.
True.
And the point that you made, let food be thy medicine and medicine be thy food, is very well said. And the University of California, Robert Lustwick, who's talking on this issue. The bitter sweet truth.
Yeah, the bitter sweet truth.
And then let food be thy medicine.
True.
Here, Dr. B.M. Hegde, Wothi Ferasli, is talking on different
Manipal
aspects of medicine.
Institute, yeah.
But one thing I've got to say, in the present modern times, the food industry, the medical industry, and the pharmaceutical are all three contributing the very ugly side of, the bad health.
True.
If you go step into a hospital, by and large, there are exceptions. The good, bad, and the ugly. First is, there is no physician to ask you the clinical history. If there's any simple problem, immediately testing.
True, I agree.
So that is one big problem. And then overload of medicines. Take this, take this, take this. And then when you're buying food, you've got to be very careful looking at the label. If I look at the label, I don't want to touch any food, processed food.
Correct.
I was a lucky one, like you, in my growing up, we had food at home. From class 1 to PhD, my food came in a stainless steel tiffin box to where I was studying.
Great. Yeah, true. No, I think I
agree
with you.
Discipline in eating habits, we went through. Now, people are eating just about any kachra, anytime.
Yeah, yeah. True. See, but then I think we need to right
to
now
change our, our lifestyle. We have got to pay attention.
I agree. But then I think we need to, evolve ourselves to fit into the generation as well. We can't kind of take them out of whatever junk is. So we need to really, one side awareness and one side a balance we need to bring in, because it is going to take time. The generation is going to learn, but it will take time. We need to be patient. And then, for example, we have to be creative. If they love pizza, we'll have to, I keep giving them recipes, for example, of, dosa pizza, so with the dosa base. What the problem in the pizza is the base of the pizza, which is the maida, refined flour. Change the base, and I think if they want to have a pizza, that my son used to tell me, oh, you tell me you're giving me a pizza, you will remove the base first, maida, then you will say next thing, then you will call it a pizza.
But, apart from that, even simple wheat, a bread will be labeled as 100% whole wheat. When you really read it, there is nothing like 100% whole wheat.
True.
Very rarely.
Yeah.
And processed foods, now there's another trick. Simple, our Parry and Company making sugar. They took plain white sugar and put some Ayurvedic herbs, 10 little types. And then brown sugar, they did the same thing. Now jaggery, they've done the same thing. There's no need for all this nonsense.
See, I think we should stick to basics.
You really have to look at
basics.
When you look at it, the only thing I'm frightened of now is being human.
I'm not. I'm happy I am one. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Thanks for the opportunity, and thank you, Mr. Ramkumar, for having me this evening.
I request Nancy to respond.